Hello, you are listening to Dr. Sushma Singh today in Chapter 1, Political Theory and Introduction. Let us start with the topic, Putting Political Theory to Practice. In this textbook, we confine ourselves to one aspect of political theory, that which deals with the origins, meanings, and significance of political ideas that we are familiar with, such as freedom, equality, citizenship, justice, development, nationalism, secularism, and so on. When we begin a debate or argument on any one topic, we usually ask, what does it mean? And how does it matter? Political theorists have asked what is freedom or equality and provided diverse definitions. Unlike in mathematics, where one can be one definition of a triangle or square, we encounter many definitions of equality or freedom or justice. This is because terms like equality concern our relationship with other human beings rather than with things. Human beings, unlike things, have opinions on issues like equality, and many opinions need to be understood and harmonized. How do we go about doing this? Let us begin with our common experience of equality in different places. We may have noticed that people often jump the queue in shops or doctor's waiting room or government offices. Sometimes those who do so are told to get back in line and we feel glad. Sometimes they get ahead and we feel cheated. We resent this because we all want equal opportunities to get goods and services for which we are paying. So, when we reflect on our experience, we understand that the equality means equal opportunity for all. At the same time, if there are separate counters for the old and disabled, we understand that such special treatment may be justified. But we also notice every day that many poor people cannot go to the shop or to the doctor because they have no money to pay for goods and services. Some of these people could be day laborers who are cutting stones or lugging bricks for hours. If we are sensitive, we feel that it is not fair that in a society, some members cannot even have their basic needs satisfied. We come to realize that equality must involve some kind of fairness so that people are not unduly exploited and disadvantaged by economic factors. Consider the fact that there are many children who cannot go to school because they have to work to feed themselves, and most girls, students in poor households are pulled out of school to care for their younger siblings while parents go to work. Even though the Indian Constitution guarantees the right to primary education for all, this right remains formal. Again, we may feel that the government should do more for such children and their parents so that they are enabled to go to school. Thus, we may see that our idea of equality is quite complex. When we are in a queue or playground, we want equal opportunity. If we suffer from some disability, we want special provisions made. When we cannot even afford basic needs, equal opportunities is not enough. We must be unable to go to school or get help through proactive measures such as fair distribution of resources like jobs, decent wages, subsidized hospital, etc. This requires that some agency be made responsible to ensure fairness. So the reason we have many definitions is because the meaning of equality is dependent on the context. We started with what it meant for ourselves and then proceeded to consider others, like the poor, disadvantaged, senior citizens, etc. We discovered many layers of meanings. We have been doing political theory without realizing it. Political theorists clarify the meaning of political concepts by looking at how they are understood and used in ordinary language. They also debate and examine the diverse meanings and opinions in a systematic manner. When is equality of opportunity enough? When do people need special treatment? How far and how long should such special treatment be given? Should poor children be given midday meals to encourage them to stay in schools? These are some questions which they address. As we can see, these issues are eminently practical. They provide guidelines for framing public policies on education and employment. As in the case of equality, so also in the case of other concepts, political theorists engage with everyday opinions, debate possible meanings, and thresh out policy options, freedom, citizenship, rights, development, justice, equality, nationalism, and secularism are some of the concepts that we will discuss in other chapters. Now let us discuss why should we study political theory. We may have political ideas, but do we need to study political theory? Is it not more suited for politicians who practice politics, or for bureaucrats who make policies, or for those who teach political theory, or for lawyers and judges who interpret the constitution and laws, or for the activists and journalists who expose exploitation and demand new rights? What do we gain by knowing the meaning of freedom or equality? First of all, political theory is relevant for all the above target groups. As a high school student, we may choose one of the above professions in the future, and so indirectly it is relevant for us even now. Do we not learn mathematics, although not all of us will become mathematician or engineer? Is it not because basic arithmetic is useful to life in general? Secondly, we are all going to be citizens entitled to vote and decide other issues. to act responsibly, it is helpful to have a basic knowledge of the political ideas and institutions that shape the world we live in. In the information society, it is crucial that we learn to be reasonable and informed if we are to participate in Gram Sabha or offer our views on websites and polls. If we simply express arbitrary preferences, we will not be very effective. But if we are thoughtful and mature, we can use the new media to discuss and express our common interests. As citizens, we are a bit like the audience in a music concert. We are not the main performers interpreting the song and melody, but we set the agenda and appropriate the output and put in new requests. Have we noticed that musicians perform better when they know the audience is knowledgeable and appreciative? So also, an educated and vigilant citizenry makes those who play politics more public-spirited. Thirdly, freedom, equality, and secularism are not abstract issues in our lives. We daily encounter discrimination of various sorts in families, school, colleges, shopping malls, and so on. We ourselves have prejudices against people who are different from us, be they of a different caste or religion or gender or class. If we feel oppressed, we want to it redressed, and if that is delayed, we may feel violent revolution is justified. If we are privileged, we deny that there is any oppression, even as our maids and servants struggle for dignity sometimes. We even feel that our servants deserve the treatment they get. What political theory encourages us to do is examine our ideas and feelings about political things. Just by looking at them more carefully, we become moderate in our ideas and feelings. Finally, as a student, we enjoy debates and elocution competitions. We have options about what is right or wrong, just or unjust, but do not know whether they are reasonable or not. Only when we argue with others, we realize the need to defend them and seek out reasons and arguments. Political theory exposes us to systematic thinking on justice or equality so that we can polish our opinions and argue in an informed manner and for the sake of common interests. Such skills of debating rationally and communicating effectively are likely to be great assets in the global informational order. With this, we have come to the end of the chapter. Thanks for the great listening.